Hello once again, friends, neighbors, and fellow Christians, and welcome back to another lesson in this series of videos where we have been studying and researching the last days kingdom that was foretold in Moses and the prophets that it would come in this biblical period referred to as the last days. And we find this in the prophecies of the Old Testament. We find it in the ministry, the teachings of the apostles and the early evangelists. That they too, quoting from the Old Testament prophecies, that they were referring to this period of time referred to as the last days. And so again, we have identified that as the last days of Israel, the end of the age, the end of the Mosaic age. And if you're new to this series of studies, I pray that you will go back to the beginning and follow through with all of these lessons as we build one upon another. And we are presently in our series of lessons here, taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, where Paul is speaking and teaching about the resurrection, that being one of those promises that was associated with the coming of the kingdom, the second coming, the judgment, and so forth. And again, this was a promise that was made to Old Covenant Israel, Romans chapter 9. And as Paul is explaining here, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and he is rebutting the argument, the false doctrine that some in Corinth were teaching and denying resurrection of the dead ones. And so he is explaining that, and he is taking so much of his teaching that we find here out of Moses and the prophets. And even Paul himself said in Acts chapter 26 that his doctrine of the resurrection and the coming of Christ was taken solely from Moses and the prophets. He taught and believed nothing else but that of Moses and the prophets. And so when Paul says, as it is written, then it's just good common sense for us to go back and see where he is taking his statement from, that being the Old Testament prophecies. And so we are down in our study here to the portion where he says in verse 51, "Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed." All right, now again, this is verse 52. Of the text here, and because this is dealing with the last trump, now remember in the last two lessons we have looked at Revelation chapter 14 and a little more in depth in the previous lesson, because that is during the last trump. Now, when we think about these events and we look at these things, we have to realize when we are looking at the biblical eschaton, the end of all these things, that when we find a particular element in one text, and again, the eschaton, that consisted of the second coming, the resurrection, and the judgment. Of course, in the futurist paradigm, they include the end of time. The Bible does not speak of the end of time. We've established that in previous lessons, so I'm not going to go over that again. But we have these elements of the second coming, the parousia of Christ, and the resurrection of the dead ones, as we're studying here, and the judgment, the opening of the book's judgment. So when we find a text that talks about the judgment, then the resurrection is inherent, because these things are synergistically linked. And they are spoken of so many times in the apostles' ministries as if it is just one event. And it is. Even though there's different aspects, and that's what we talked about with resurrection, there are different aspects of the resurrection. There's just one resurrection. But there's different facets. There's different aspects of that. And so when we look at one text and we have this element mentioned of the resurrection or the judgment or the parousia, then the other elements are inherent in that, again, because they are linked. You can't have the second coming without the resurrection. And you can't have the judgment without the second coming. And so, again, that's how these things are linked together. And so when we show people how that in, you know, you have this one element here, and then we look back at other passages and how that these things are used, then they begin to suffer from what we would call PTSD or post-traumatic scriptural dysfunction, just to use a little, to be a little bit facetious there. But it's true. It's absolutely true. Some people cannot allow themselves to believe that they've misunderstood and been wrong in things in the past and for so long a period of time. And again, that's hard for me to wrap my mind around how people think that way, because I'll go into the study, to the scriptures, and be looking at something and say, wow, look at that. Look what I have missed all these years. How could I have missed this and been wrong all these years on this particular thing? And that's how we have to look at the scriptures, folks. God's word is true. It doesn't matter what my opinion, what my emotions, how I react to these things, God's word is true. And that's one of the things, in a discussion with a brother, Brother Robert Waters, in showing him these things, I asked him the question, is there more than one coming of the Son of Man in the clouds of heaven with the holy angels for the judgment? And he said, evidently. I mean, come on. Everybody knows there's only one. But that's how the mind, the human mind works. Because I have believed for so long this is in the future, then evidently there has to be more than one. And again, that's the PTSD thing there. We have to get around that. We have to allow the Bible to interpret itself. And so as we look at these texts, when we look at the dead being raised at the last trump, well, there's other texts, like Revelation 14, that speak of the dead being raised. It speaks of the harvest, as we've shown, fulfillment of Joel 3, Matthew 13, and Matthew 24. But when we look at these texts, there's another one that we have to look at. Because as we go on in our text, where Paul says, this corruptible must put on incorruption, this mortal must put on immortality. So when, and there's that time word again, so when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then, there's another time word, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written. So there it is again. Paul is quoting from somewhere in the Holy Scriptures. Now again, remember, the New Testament wasn't written yet. He's quoting from the Old Testament Scriptures. And so when we look at this, the dead being raised at the last trump, there's another text we just have to look at. And again, what I was going to there, where he says, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? Where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? What is amazing here to me is that in all the places, and I forgot to notate the number of times, and I've done it in the past, but however many times the word Hades is used in the New Testament, the Greek word Hades, it is all, in the King James Version, it is always rendered hell, except for this one place right here, 1 Corinthians 15:55, where it is translated grave. That is such a pitiful translation of this word. Hell is bad enough, because that's just not a Greek word. It's bad enough that they have used the word hell. They should have translated it Hades and Gehenna and Sheol in the Old Testament scriptures. But to translate Hades as grave in this text here, this gives such a wrong idea of what Paul is talking about, because he is not talking about a hole in the ground. Hades is not a hole in the ground. You cannot contain a spirit. You cannot contain the soul in a physical hole in the ground, or in the rocks, a tomb, a sepulcher. You can't do that. That's not the way things work. Grave here is Hades. So anyway, We'll have more to say about that as the study goes on in the next lessons. But I wanted to show you that because when we back up to our verse 52, at the last trump, the dead shall be raised, and he's talking about death being swallowed up. O grave, Hades, where is thy victory? So that's what we want to look at. We want to look at Revelation chapter 20 because it talks about the dead ones being raised and something being done to Hades. So we're going to go to Revelation chapter 20. And we want to study from chapter 20 a little bit here. And this is another one of those times when, like I tell Bobby Allison, well, I start studying something, I say, oh, hey, look at there. And we got to go over here and look at that. And we get over there and it's, well, look at that. And it's hard to keep going in a text without being diverted by something we've studied previously, and how that's again how these things link together. And as I've been saying, once we see these parallels, we cannot unsee them. And it's just amazing how these things fit together. And there's so much in this text that I'm going to have to just skim over because of time. But anyway, it starts out in verse 1. I saw an angel come down from heaven having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. He laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil, and Satan, the accuser, and bound him 1,000 years. So there's where we get the idea of the millennium. 1,000, that's what the word means. And so this is where so many wild and fanciful ideas have come from through the decades, through the centuries, about this 1,000 years. And then most people are looking for 1,000-year reign in our future where Christ will come back and he'll come down to earth and set up a literal kingdom again, and he'll rule and reign from Jerusalem over the entire earth, and he'll reign for 1,000 years. Well, I'm sorry, that's not what the text says. It just isn't. That's not what it says, and we'll see this as we go on. All right, so he bound the devil, Satan, cast him into the bottomless pit, verse 3, shut him up and set a seal on him that he should deceive the nations no more. Now, hold on to that, and I want you to think about who the Bible refers to as the nations over and over and over again. That he should deceive the nations no more till the 1,000 years should be fulfilled. And now notice, and after that he must be loosed a little season. Well, again, remembering that Revelation recapitulates, it tells the same story again and again and again, using different terminology, using different sets of symbols. It's telling the same thing over and over again. This is parallel. This being loosed for a little season, this is parallel to Revelation chapter 12, verse 12. Therefore, rejoice, you heavens, and you that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, for the devil is come down unto you, having great wrath, notice, because he knows that he has but a short time. So you'd be loosed for just a little season. This would be when the 1,000 years are finished. All right? That he would be loosed for this little season. And I point back to Revelation 12. Why? Because Revelation 12 is during the seventh trump. That's our text. At the last trump, the dead shall be raised. Remember in Revelation 8, seven angels are given seven trumpets. They begin to sound. The first one sounds his trumpet, things happen. The second one sounds his trumpet, more things happen. And they sound in succession until we come to chapter 10. And the angel which I saw stand upon the sea and upon the earth lifted up his hand to heaven. Folks, that's Daniel 12 right there. That's Daniel 12, verse 4 and following. And swear by him that liveth forever and ever, who created the heaven and the things that are therein, and the earth and the things that are therein, and the sea, the things that are therein, that there should be time no longer. And if you look at this word here and study this phrase, this is talking about that there will be delay no longer. It's not saying that this is the end of time, and we'll see why here in just a second. But in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, that's the seventh trump, that's the last trump, when he shall begin to sound, the mystery of God should be finished, notice, as he hath declared to his servants the prophets. Folks, that's Luke 21, verse 22, where Jesus said, "These be the days of vengeance, that all things that are written will be fulfilled." That's Matthew 5, 17, and 18, that heaven and earth would pass away when all things written in the law and the prophets are fulfilled. And we drop down to verse 11, Revelation 10. Notice, he said unto me, "Thou must prophesy again before many peoples and nations and tongues and kings." You see why this can't be an end of time thing? It'd be pretty difficult, wouldn't it, for John to prophesy again before peoples and nations and tongues and kings when the universe has been destroyed. You see how that it's just impossible? And again, that shows that at the seventh trump, this is not talking about the end of time. All right, so again, this is again showing that he must be loosed for a little season here in chapter 20. This is parallel to Revelation chapter 12, which is during the seventh trump. All right, and I saw thrones and they that sat upon them, and judgment was given to them. And I saw, notice this, I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus. These are the souls that were under the altar back in chapter 6, who cried out, "How long, O Lord, is it going to be till you judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth?" I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands. And they. Who is they? Who is this pronoun referring to? The souls of them who were beheaded. They lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. We see he just said, "I saw thrones and they that sat upon them." So here is a scene where, from back in chapter 6, the souls who were beheaded were under the altar. Here they are elevated to thrones. This is a figurative resurrection. You see that? But the rest of the dead lived not again until the 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. Now notice this, "Blessed and holy is he that hath part in the first resurrection. On such, the second death hath no power." Now notice this, if we look back at chapter 2, John writes here, and he says, "He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. He that overcomes shall not be hurt of the second death." Do you see that? To overcome, persecution and so forth, to overcome would be to not be affected by the second death. Well, here in this text, he who has part in the first resurrection, on such the second death hath no power. So again, things equal to the same thing are equal to each other. So the first resurrection is overcoming persecution. All right, again, from verse 4, we just read that "I saw thrones and them that sat on them." We just read that verse and showed you that, and how that in Revelation 6, verses 9 and 10, this under the when the fifth seal was opened, he saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony that they held. They cried with a loud voice, saying, "How long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth?" All right, again, so now these souls have been elevated to thrones. This is the first resurrection. They have overcome the persecution, and the second death will have no power on them. He says, but they, again, who is the they? Who does this pronoun they refer to? Those who were slain, and now they're on thrones. They were beheaded for the witness of Jesus. Verse 4, he says, they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. Now, again, in passing, notice that in verse 4, they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. Where does this text say that Christ is on a throne on earth over a literal kingdom? It doesn't say that. It's not there. This is not the reign of Christ. This is the reign of those souls who were beheaded, who are now elevated to thrones. They lived and reigned with Christ. Do you see that? That's again, people When they've been told a lie, and I don't mean that derogatory, but when they've been told something false for so long, they literally can read a text and they see words in that text that are not there. That's, again, that's the strange way that the human brain works. We can believe something so strongly that our mind actually inserts words into the text that are not there. This text does not say Christ will reign on earth or even did. It does not say that he will reign on a throne on the earth over a literal kingdom. All right, now, please notice in verse 7. And when, there's another one of them time words. And when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison. Well, again, that would be for that little time that he knows he only has a little time that we just read and referred to back in Revelation chapter 12. This is parallel. And this would be when the millennium has come to its end. Do you see that? But now notice, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison. And what shall he do? Verse 8. He shall go out to deceive the nations. There's that again. He shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them to battle. Now, folks, if you will look at this verse, you will notice that John defined who Gog and Magog are. The nations. Do you see that? The Satan shall be loosed. He'll go out to deceive the nations which are in the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog. It's the nations. To gather them to battle, the number of whom, that's Gog and Magog, the nations, the number of whom is as the sand of the sea. Now, folks, I've got a question for you. Who is referred to consistently throughout the Old Testament scriptures as that their number would be as the sand of the sea? The descendants of Abraham. The descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Israel. You see that? This is talking about the judgment. I'm going to prove this. This is talking about the judgment of Old Covenant Israel. Those who rejected Jesus, who murdered Jesus, who killed and persecuted the apostles, who slew the Old Testament prophets, as Jesus said there in Matthew 23, that all the righteous bloodshed would come upon you, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem. All right, now, we're going to do a little bit of reading here. Gog and Magog. John is appropriating what he is saying here in this text from Ezekiel 38 and 39. And I want you to notice this. We're going to, and again, take the time, stop and take the time to read, actually read chapter 37 first and continue reading right on through chapter 39. But specifically, chapters 38 and 39, because this is where Gog and Magog are referred to there. And John is appropriating that Old Testament prophecy here in our text in Revelation 20. All right. Again, take the time to read all of it. I'm just going to hit a few points here to make some points here. All right, in verse 8 of Ezekiel 38, after many days thou shalt be visited in the latter years. You see that? That's the last days. That's a parallel phrase to the last days. In the latter years thou shalt come into the land that is brought back from the sword and is gathered out of many people against the mountains of Israel, which have been always waste, but it is brought forth out of the nations, and they shall dwell safely, all of them. All right, drop down to verse 14, beginning there in chapter, if I can get this pop-up to stay put, here in chapter 38. Therefore, son of man, referring to Ezekiel, prophesy and say unto Gog, thus saith the Lord God, in that day, when my people of Israel, do you see the subject? In that day when my people of Israel dwells safely, thou shalt not know it. And thou shalt come from the place out of the north parts, thou and many people with thee, all of them riding upon horses, a great company and a mighty army. And thou shalt come up against my people of Israel as a cloud to cover the land. It shall be in the latter days, and I will bring thee against my land, that the heathen may know me, when I shall be sanctified in thee, O Gog, before their eyes. Thus saith the Lord God, art thou he of whom I have spoken in old time by my servants the prophets of Israel, which prophesied in those days many years, that I would bring thee against them? Do you see that? That I would bring thee against them? He's going to bring Gog against Israel. Do you see that? And it shall come to pass at the same time when Gog shall come against the land of Israel, when Gog shall come against the land of Israel. Do you see that? Saith the Lord God, that my fury shall come upon, or shall come up in my face. For in my jealousy and in the fire of my wrath have I spoken. Surely in that day there shall be a great shaking in the land of Israel. Joel chapter 3, Matthew 24, verse 29, Hebrews chapter 12. So that the fishes of the seas and the fowls of the heaven and the beasts of the field and the creeping things that creep upon the earth and all men that are upon the face of the earth shall shake at my presence. Isaiah chapter 2. And the mountains shall be thrown down and the, and I can't see the last sentence there in verse 20. So take the time to read that. It doesn't show up in my pop-up. So let's drop down and get verse 22. And I will plead against him with pestilence and with blood, and I will rain upon him and upon his bands and upon many people that are with him. And notice, and overflowing rain and great hailstones, fire and brimstone. Look back at Revelation chapter 16 and verse 21. There fell upon men a great hail out of heaven, every stone about the weight of a talent. And men blasphemed God because of the plague of the hail. Josephus records that the projectiles from the big catapults were white, big round, big marbles. They were big round marbles, and they weighed about a talent. And those things rained down on the city of Jerusalem. Isn't that interesting? All right, let's look at chapter 39 of Ezekiel, verse 4. Thou shalt fall upon the mountains of Israel, thou and all thy bands, and the people that is with thee, and I will give thee unto the ravenous birds of every sort, and to the beasts of the field to be devoured. Well, look what we see just in the previous chapter here of Revelation. Back in chapter 19, just a few verses prior to where we're reading right here, I saw an angel standing in the sun. He cried with a loud voice, saying to all the fowls that fly in the midst of heaven, come, gather yourselves together unto the supper of the great God, that you may eat the flesh of kings, the flesh of captains, the flesh of mighty men, and the flesh of horses, and them that sit on them, and the flesh of all men, both free and bond, both small and great. What does that remind you of, folks? Matthew 24, 28, wheresoever the carcass is, thither will the eagles be gathered together. And the parallel verse in Luke 17 and verse 37, when Jesus had told them about the days of Noah, it's parallel to Matthew 24, 37 and following. He said there, in specific response to when the kingdom would come, Luke 17, 20, wheresoever the body is, thither will the eagles be gathered together. Notice that. Whithersoever the body is, thither will the eagles be gathered together. Again, folks, once you see these parallels, you cannot unsee them. Ezekiel 39, verse 11, it shall come to pass in that day that I will give unto Gog a place there of graves in Israel, the valley of the passengers of on the east of the sea, and it shall stop the noses of the passengers. In other words, death, decay, putrefying bodies, the stench would just be overwhelming. There shall they bury Gog and all his multitude, and they shall call it the Valley of Hamon Gog. Now, again, this is another one of the things you see this and you go, wow. And there's so many things that need to be tied into this that I don't have time to do. Maybe we can do that in a future study. But the Valley of Ham and Gog, this is parallel to the Valley of Tophet, which is, that's the Hebrew, and the Greek equivalent is Gehenna. All right. Go on in chapter 39 reading, verse 21. And I will set my glory among the heathen. That's the Gentiles, folks. When did God set his glory among the Gentiles? Is that something to be done yet at the end of time? I will set my glory among the heathen, and all the heathen shall see my judgment that I have executed, and my hand that I have laid upon them. So the house of Israel shall know that I am the Lord their God from that day forward. And the heathen shall know that the house of Israel went into captivity for their iniquity, because they trespassed against me. They have broken the covenant. Back to Deuteronomy 30 through 32. Therefore hid I my face from them and gave them into the hand of their enemies. So fell they all by the sword. According to their uncleanness and according to their transgressions have I done unto them, and hid my face from them. Therefore thus saith the Lord God, now will I bring again the captivity of Jacob and have mercy upon the whole house of Israel. Have mercy upon the whole house of Israel. This is why I suggested that you read chapter 37 through chapter 39. Because when you find this element, this constituent element of the whole house of Israel, then you need to do some study. Because when you back up to chapter 37, the resurrection, beginning in chapter 1, halfway down, through that chapter, you have the vision of the two sticks, which represents the reunification of both houses of Israel. And that would be at the time that they would receive the new everlasting covenant. Folks, again, is that something we're looking for in our future? No, that happened in the first century, that the everlasting covenant was established, and God placed his tabernacle with man, that he would dwell with man and be their God and they would be his people. I will have mercy upon the whole house of Israel and will be jealous for my holy name. After they have borne their shame and all their trespasses whereby they have trespassed against me, when they dwelt safely in their land and none made them afraid, when I have brought them again from the people and gathered them out of their enemies' lands, and am sanctified in them in the sight of many nations, then shall they know that I am the Lord their God, which caused them to be led into captivity among the heathen. But I have gathered them. Folks, what's the gathering? That's the harvest. That's Matthew 24. The gathering, the harvest. But I have gathered them unto their own land, and have left none of them any more there. Neither will I hide my face any more from them, for I have poured out my spirit upon the house of Israel. Folks, again, when did God pour out his spirit on the house of Israel? That's first century, folks. There's no way around this if we let the Bible interpret itself. All right, so he says that Satan would be loosed. He would go out to deceive the nations, Gog and Magog, bring them together to battle, of whom their number would be of the sand of the sea. And they went upon the breadth of the earth, Revelation 20, verse 9, and compassed the camp of the saints about and the beloved city. All right, again, folks, in Revelation, what is the beloved city? The beloved city is not Rome, folks. The beloved city is not New York City, okay? It's not America. The beloved city is Jerusalem. That holy city, that great city, which spiritually is called Sodom and Egypt. The harlot that we just read about in the previous chapter. All right, previous two chapters. All right, so they went up on the breadth of the earth and compassed the camp of the saints about, and the blessing, they compassed the camp of the saints. Again, what does that remind you of, folks? Luke 19, Jesus said, "For the days shall come upon thee that thine enemies shall cast a trench about thee and compass thee round and keep thee in on every side and lay thee even with the ground and thy children within thee. And they shall not leave in thee one stone upon another, because thou knewest not the time of thy visitation." Again, Luke 21, when you see Jerusalem compassed with armies, then know that the desolation thereof is nigh. All right. They went up on the breadth of the earth, compassed the camp of the saints about and the beloved city, and fire came down out of God, and fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. And the devil, now notice this, and the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. All right, now again, this is where mankind goes into this literal physical mindset of interpreting things physically and literally, and they miss the hyperbole that is being used here, this judgment language which is hyperbolic. It is just like what we read in Isaiah 34. Notice Isaiah 30, again, read the whole chapter. But notice, "And all the hosts of heaven shall be dissolved." See how that's the exact language that Peter uses in 2 Peter 3. But anyway, "And all the hosts of heaven shall be dissolved, and the heavens shall be rolled together as a scroll," Hebrews 1, "and all their hosts shall fall down as the leaf falleth off from the vine, as a falling fig from the fig tree. My sword shall be bathed in heaven, for it shall, behold, it shall come down upon," the King James Version says, Idumea, that's Edom. "It shall come down upon Edom and upon the people of my curse to judgment." Notice this was a judgment of the Lord upon Edom. But notice the language is being used there. "For the sword of the Lord is filled with blood. It is made fat with fatness, and with the blood of lambs and goats, and the fat of kidneys and rams. For the Lord hath sacrifice in Bozrah, and a great slaughter in the land of Edom." Continue reading. "For it is the day of the Lord." Do you see that? "For it is the day of the Lord's vengeance and the year of recompenses for the controversy of Zion." Now notice this language here. "The streams thereof shall be turned into pitch, and the dust thereof into brimstone, and the land thereof shall become burning pitch. It shall not be quenched night nor day. The smoke thereof shall go up forever. From generation to generation it shall lie waste. None shall pass through it forever and ever." And if you continue reading on down through the text, you'll see that there are wild animals living there. There's briars and brambles growing there. Again, this is hyperbolic language. It is judgment language. And it is talking about just complete and utter destruction and desolation that came upon the land of Edom. This occurred in our past. Again, this is the kind of picture language. This is how the Hebrews thought. This is how they communicated with this picture type language. Utter desolation. It doesn't mean the end of the universe. All right, verse 11, "And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them." Oh my goodness, how many things do you see right there in that one verse? That is Daniel 7, verses 9 through 13. I'm not going to read the text. We're familiar with them, but you can see the pop-up there on the screen. That is Luke 9, 26. "For whosoever shall be ashamed of me and of my words, of him shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he shall come in his own glory and in the Father's and of the holy angels." There's some standing here. They'll not taste of death till they see the kingdom of God. Again, this is all language referring to the coming of the kingdom, just like in Luke chapter 17. Verses 20 and following. All right, that is Matthew 25, verses 31 and following, that the Son of Man would come in his own glory, and all the holy angels with him. Then would he sit upon the throne of his glory. And we have that great judgment scene there in Matthew chapter 25. All right, again, Daniel 7, verse 14, there was given him dominion and glory and a kingdom that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion. Notice what I'm getting at here. This is at the time of the establishment of the everlasting kingdom. It is not at this assumed this assumed time of decreation, the destruction of the entire universe. This is the time of the creation, the establishment of the everlasting kingdom. All right, again, repeated in verse 18 of Daniel 7, the saints of the Most High shall take the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever, even forever and ever. Again, in verse 22, that this would be the judgment of the little horn would last until the Ancient of Days came. Judgment was given to the saints of the Most High. The time came that the saints possessed the kingdom. It's reiterated in verse 27. And again, this is the fulfillment of Daniel 2 and verse 44, which is practically where we began this series of lessons, was in Daniel 2. The days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. Now again, folks, we know, nearly everybody understands, at least in the churches of Christ, that this is talking about the establishment of the everlasting messianic kingdom during the days of the fourth empire, the fourth world empire, which is the Roman Empire. This is first century. We understand this. So when we understand that, then when we back up and look at the verses we've just covered there, you just can't get over this. Again, Ezekiel 37 that we referred to earlier, I'll make a covenant of peace with them. It should be an everlasting covenant with them. And I will place them and multiply them and will set my sanctuary in the midst of them forevermore. My tabernacle also shall be with them. I will be their God and they shall be my people, which Paul quotes verbatim to these Corinthians in his second letter, telling them they are what Ezekiel foretold and that they had, having received these promises, dearly beloved, chapter 7 and verse 1. Paul quotes this verse verbatim and applies it during his ministry to these very Corinthians. All right, now in Revelation 20, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away. Again, that's Matthew 24, 30. That's Matthew 5, 17 that we've referred to. That is Luke 21 and verse 31. So likewise you, when you see these things come to pass, know ye that the kingdom of God is nigh at hand. Folks, you can't get around this, that Jesus tied the coming of the kingdom to a literal physical event. And that was the demolition of the Jewish temple. That at that time, again, Jesus said, when you, and again, when we stop and think about this, why would Jesus tell his disciples, in particular Peter, James, John, and Andrew in this setting, why would he tell his disciples to be watching for these things? Don't let these things come upon you unexpectedly if it wasn't going to happen in their lifetime. Again, I mean, this is just basic common sense when we look and allow the Bible to interpret itself. Jesus tied the coming of the kingdom to a literal physical event. Again, that was the demolition of the Jewish temple. All right, heaven and earth fled away. Again, Revelation 1 and verse 7. Behold, he comes with clouds. That's Revelation 14 that we've looked at. That's Matthew 24, 30, which is Daniel 7. Behold, he comes with the clouds. Every eye will see him. They also which pierced him. And all kindreds of the earth shall wail. That is a verbatim quote in Matthew 24, 30. And all the kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Again, heaven and earth would pass away. That is Hebrews 1, verses 10 through 12. And thou, Lord, in the beginning hast laid the foundation of the earth. The heavens are the work of thine hands. They shall perish, but thou remainest. And they all shall wax old as doth a garment. And as a vesture shalt thou fold them up, and they shall be changed. They shall be changed. Do you see that? But thou art the same, and thy years fail not. Now, the reason I emphasize they shall be changed is, and probably need to go on down a verse or two to tie that together with 2 Corinthians chapter 3. I don't have that note in this particular verse. They shall be changed. Well, that's what Paul said in our text in 1 Corinthians 15. They shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. And that's what Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, that they are being transformed, they are being changed from glory to glory. The last verse there in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, they are being changed, transformed from the glory of the old into the glory of the new. This is the heavens and the earth passing away, folks. It's not talking about the material creation ceasing to exist. And Hebrews 1 is taken from Psalms 102. Again, read the entire psalm. But notice verses 25 through 27. Of old, thou hast laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of thy hands. They shall perish, but thou shalt endure. Yea, all of them shall wax old like a garment. What did Paul say in chapter 10 of Hebrews? Chapter 8 of Hebrews. When he was quoting from Jeremiah 31 and following, he said, now that which is decaying and waxing old, that which is decaying and waxing old, is becoming obsolete, is ready to vanish away. Talking, and he was contrasting the two covenants. All right, they shall perish, thou shalt endure. All them shall wax old like a garment. As a vesture, thou shalt change them, and they shall be changed. Again, that's Paul in Hebrews 1 is quoting from Psalms 102. Paul opens an inclusio here talking about the passing away of heaven and earth, the establishment of the kingdom in chapter 1, and he's still talking about that over in chapter 12. When he says, see that you refuse not him that speaks, for if they escape not who refused him that spake on earth, Moses, much more shall we not escape if we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven, whose voice then shook the earth, Mount Sinai, whose voice then shook the earth, but now hath he promised, saying, yet once more I shake not the earth only, but also heaven. And this word, yet once more, signifies now, the removing of those things that are shaken, those things that are being shaken. That's the old covenant. That's Judaism. As of things that are made, that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. Wherefore, we receiving, present tense, we receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken. Again, do you see the contrast of the two covenants? He's contrasting the two covenants in chapter 1. He's still contrasting the covenants in chapter 12. This creates an inclusio. In other words, the entire book of Hebrews is talking about the coming of the kingdom and the passing away of the first covenant. That's just to put it bluntly and in short layman's terms. And again, this is Revelation 21, verses 1 through 5, where John sees the new heaven and the new earth. Why? Because the first heaven and the first earth passed away. That's what he says right here in chapter 20. The heaven and the earth fled away. There was no place found for them. And again, this is taken from Isaiah 65, verses 17 through 19. We're familiar with that. We've covered that many times there. All right, so verse 12 then, and I saw the dead. Now again, folks, this is plural. I saw the dead ones. This is who Paul is talking about in our text in 1 Corinthians 15. This is who the sum were denying resurrection to. And I saw the dead ones, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. Folks, that is Daniel 7, the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with the holy angels, for the opening of the book's judgment. That is Daniel chapter 12, the resurrection of the just and the unjust at the time of the great tribulation, the unparalleled tribulation, and the judgment of those that are not written in a book. And here we have it right here. This is the fulfillment of Daniel 7 and Daniel 12. I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened, and another book was open, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. That is Matthew 16, 27, which is also, I believe it's Isaiah 40. I have to look that up and put it on the screen. Maybe Isaiah 60 there in that verse. Oh, look there. I've got it right there. Let's see. The books were open. So here's the verses I just referred to, Daniel 7, 10, Daniel 12, 1 and 2. Again, John 5, 28 and 29, where Jesus is talking about all in the graves will come forth. They'll hear his voice. They'll come forth. They that have done good to the resurrection of life. They that have done evil to the resurrection of damnation. That's taken from Daniel 12, because Daniel 12 is the only prophecy of a resurrection of both the just and the unjust. So when Jesus talks about the resurrection of the good, the resurrection of the evil, he's talking about Daniel 12. Paul quotes Daniel 12 in Acts 24, 15, saying that there is about to be a resurrection of the dead, both of the just and the unjust. And this is 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 10, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he had done, whether it be good or bad. Go back and read verse 1 of this chapter, and notice how he talks about there the tabernacle. Just read that and notice that. Okay, and Isaiah 40 was what I was thinking of here. Behold, the Lord God will come with a strong hand, and his arm shall rule for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his work before him. It's reiterated in Isaiah 62, verse 11. Behold, the Lord hath proclaimed unto the end of the world and the ends of the earth, say ye to the daughter of Zion, behold, thy salvation comes. Behold, his reward is with him, and his work before him. That's our verse right here in Revelation 20 and verse 13. But now notice, please, just in passing, they were judged every man according to their works. That's why James could write, you see then how that by works a man is justified and not by faith only. Isn't that interesting? All right. And again, death, in verse 14, and death and hell, again, this is a pitiful translation, this is Hades. And death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. All right, just bear with me, just a few more verses here and we'll be done. I didn't think I'd actually get this far. But note, and again, I point this out, that death and again, we've got to go back and we've got to look at the language. The King James Version says, and death and hell. When you look at the original language, it says, and the death and the Hades were cast into the lake of fire. And when the King James translators leave out the definite article, that changes the entire thrust of the passage. The death and the Hades. See, he's talking about a specific death, and that is the same, the death, that Paul is talking about in our text in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. The death. They personify death. The death and the Hades were cast into the lake of fire. And I emphasize that because we read in Hosea 13, 14, I will ransom them from the power of the grave. I will redeem them from death. O death, I will be thy plagues. O grave, I will be thy destruction. Repentance shall be hid from mine eyes. Now, let's look at that verse. Let's look at that in the King James 3. Same verse. I will ransom them from the hand of Sheol. I will redeem them from death. O death, where are your plagues? O Sheol, where is your ruin? So you see, when Paul quoted that in our text, 1 Corinthians 15, he used Hades, because Hades is the Greek equivalent of the Hebrew Sheol. And Paul, and it's unquestionable that Paul is quoting from Hosea 13, 14. And that's why I'm emphasizing that, and you can look at that. But there it is. But when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the word, the one having been written, death is swallowed up in victory. Actually I'm sorry, I got a typo there. I've got 1 Corinthians 15, 54 through 54. So forgive me for that. That should have been 55 there in my footnote. But well, let's look at it. O death, where is your sting? Hades, where is your victory? And see, they even put the notation there that these in the KJ3 of Hosea 13, 14. That's why I say it's unquestionable that Paul is quoting in our text from Hosea 13, 14. He began this chapter, if we recognize the chapter and verse divisions, he began this discourse by quoting from Hosea chapter 6 and verse 2, which is the only prophecy of a third day resurrection. And here he is closing the discourse by quoting Hosea 13, 14 and Isaiah 25 and verse 8, which we'll look at those, Lord willing, in upcoming lessons. Okay, so let me get back right here. And so I wanted to look at this. And the death and the Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. All right, now I'll go back to the King James because that's what we're familiar with. All right, now again, this lake of fire, notice in Matthew 25, that judgment scene, then shall he say also unto them on the left hand, depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. Well, that's exactly what we've just read right here in Revelation 20. Verse 46, they shall go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into life eternal. Do you see that? All right, now I'm going to throw you something to chew on for a while. And that's the reason that I mentioned earlier about that the battle, they would go forth and look on the carcasses, and it would be called the Valley of Hamengog, and that's parallel with Tophet, which is the Hebrew, and the Greek equivalent is Gehenna. Just notice this. When Jesus said in Mark chapter 9, if thy hand offend thee, cut it off. For it is better for thee to enter into life maimed than having two hands to go into hell. And again, that's Gehenna there in the original. Into Gehenna, into the fire that shall never be quenched. Now notice this. Where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. Now, we're familiar with that text. He repeats that phrase three times. In verses 43 through 48, where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. All right, now hang on to that. I want to show you something. Now, let me go back to Isaiah chapter 66. And we have demonstrated this in previous lessons, that this absolutely cannot be talking about an end of time scenario. Because he says, I know their works and their thoughts. It shall come that I will gather all nations and tongues. That's what we just read right here about the battle of Gog and Magog. I will gather all nations and tongues, and they shall come and see my glory. And I will set a sign among them, and will send them. I will send those that escape of them unto the nations, to Tarshish, Pul, Lud, Tubal, Javan, the isles afar off, that have not heard my fame, neither have seen my glory, and they shall declare my glory among the Gentiles. Again, folks, that is not end of time language, because no one could escape this end of time scene, let alone if they could, to go on and carry the gospel of Christ, the glory of Christ, to other nations that hadn't heard of him yet. But notice as we keep reading, and they shall bring all your brethren for an offering unto the Lord, out of all nations, upon horses, chariots, litters, mules, swift beasts, to my holy mountain Jerusalem, saith the Lord, as the children of Israel bring an offering in a clean vessel unto the house of the Lord. And I will also take for them priests and Levites, saith the Lord. We just read that. And my memory, I forget where, but we just read that right there in another place in the verses we've been reading. But notice this. I will also take for them priests and for Levites, saith the Lord. Now notice, for as the new heavens and the new earth, which I will make, shall remain before me, saith the Lord, so shall your seed and your name remain. Now again, this is parallel with what Isaiah said in chapter 65, the creation of the new heavens and the new earth, at the destruction of the old heavens and earth. That's what we see in Revelation 20. Heaven and earth fled away, no place found for them. That is the old covenant fading away, waxing old, becoming obsolete. It was ready to vanish away when Paul wrote Hebrews. He says, "For as the new heavens and the new earth, which I will make, this is at the time of the creation of the new heavens and the new earth." But now watch what the next verse says. "It shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, and from one Sabbath to another, shall all flesh come and worship before me, saith the Lord. And they shall go forth and look upon the carcasses of the men that have transgressed against me." Again, that's Ezekiel 39 we just read. "For their worm shall not die, neither shall their fire be quenched. And they shall be an abhorring unto all flesh." Now, folks, do you think that it's just happenstance that Jesus quotes this phrase verbatim three times in Mark chapter 9, that we find in Isaiah 66 of the condition that follows is the result of the creation of the new heavens and the new earth, the destruction of the old? Remember in chapter 65, he said Judah would be slain. They would fall by the sword. They would be slain. And he'd call his people by a new name. Again, folks, when you see these things, when you see these parallels, you just cannot unsee them. And I want you, again, I'm throwing this out for you to chew on. Think about this. Why would Jesus quote this phrase in Mark chapter 9? He's quoting this verbatim. Go back and check the language. He's quoting this verbatim. "That their worm shall not die, neither shall their fire be quenched." And folks, this is judgment language. It is the result of Old Covenant Israel's obstinance and wickedness in their idolatry and bloodshed of the prophets and so forth. They would be judged. And that was foretold back in the Song of Moses in Deuteronomy 32 that we've looked at, that in their latter days is when this would occur. And that's what Ezekiel 39, 38 and 39 said, that this would be in the latter days. And this would be a judgment against Old Covenant Israel. It's not a judgment against Rome centuries later or the America millennia later. This is confined to the context. This is confined to the judgment of Old Covenant Israel. And here in our text of 1 Corinthians 15, Paul sees at the last trump, he's foretelling at the last trump that the dead would be raised. Okay? And that's what we see here in Revelation 20, which follows the millennium. And again, because people suffer from this PTSD that I facetiously talk about there, because they cannot allow themselves to comprehend or even consider the idea that they have been wrong, then they will come back into a text like Revelation 20, and they'll start reinterpreting things. They'll start inserting parentheticals, and they'll start doing all kinds of things to be able to justify their own presuppositions. That's not how we handle the Word of God aright, folks. We have to look and respect the context, and we have to let the Bible define itself. All right, we're going to end our study here. I probably ran a little bit over, but I appreciate your time, and I hope that there's some things that we have covered here in this study that will provoke you to study your Bible. And if that's the only thing that I can do, then I'm successful. If I can just provoke you to study your Bible. But even beyond that, if I can provoke you to study your Bible in context, and that you will allow the Bible to interpret itself, then we will be on the road to unity, folks, in what God's Word says. And in particularly in the subject of studying of last things of the eschatology. And so we're going to end our study here. And again, thank you for your time. And I pray that you'll keep studying, that you'll come back and study with us again in our next lesson, and share these videos with your friends and family. and get these things out and encourage people to study the Bible. And until our next time, then, thank you so much, and may God bless you richly in your study of His Word.